Brother Wideman. Thank you, bro.
Thank you. I love you. Let's give it up for Brother Titus one more time. Amen. We thank God for what he's doing. Amen. How many people are awake this morning? That's five of you. Amen. Amen. Let's stand. Let's stretch for a little while. Amen. Let's loosen up before we get into the word of the Lord this morning. Amen. We're glad at what God did here last night. Amen. He deserves all the glory and the honor. Amen. Amen. The book of Psalms, chapter 139, verse 23, while you're standing, I want to read a verse or two, and I will let you be seated. I understand that this is a split session. Amen. So we will go a little slow today. I won't take too much time. They told me I have an hour, but I promise you, I will not use that whole hour. Everybody say amen. Amen. Psalms, chapter 139, verse 23. Let's consider verse 23 and verse 24. Amen. Psalms 139, verse 23 and 24. When you have it, say amen. I don't know if it's on the screen. It's on the screen. Amen. The Bible says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts." Verse 24, "And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Can we say amen? Amen. You can be seated. Today in this session, for a few moments, I simply want to speak on this topic, this subject, warning signs for your spiritual life. Warning signs. If you have something to write with, that'd be good in this session. If you maybe want to, if you still use paper and pen, I know everything is digital now. Everything is iPad and iPhone and Androids and all that good stuff, but if you want to take some notes, that'd be fine. Warning signs for your spiritual life. Warning signs for your spiritual life. Warning signs, they are found and seen everywhere for the sole purpose of informing or alerting us that something is wrong. In your car, if the gas light comes on, that is a warning sign that you need to pull over and do what? Get some gas. And I don't think anybody in here acts like they don't see the light that came on, or maybe some of us do. Because if you act like you didn't see that warning sign, trust me, your car is going to stop moving. It really doesn't matter how you feel about gas prices, or you know, if you're a good person, your car is eventually going to shut down. They have stop signs and yield signs on the corner of intersections to warn us of ongoing traffic. You don't say, "I don't care about these crazy laws. I do what I want to do." Because if you do that, you may end up in an accident. Even in your body, there are signs to let you know when something is not right. Fevers, high blood pressure, an irregular heartbeat, migraine headaches, pain in your left arm, dizzy spells, loss of appetite, extreme loss or gain of weight are a few of the signs to alert you to go see your doctor. And if you say, "I'm going to ignore these warning signs and act like nothing is wrong," you are doing a disservice to yourself and your loved ones. Your body is not going to get better by itself, and the pain is not going to go away. If God doesn't heal you or you do not go to the doctor, you are setting yourself up for disaster. Most people, listen to me, most people do not die because they did not know something was wrong with them, but they die because they ignore the fact that something was wrong with them. I don't care who you are, okay, how young you are. If your body is giving you signs that something is not right, don't act like it's not there. Go and get it checked out. Warning signs, they do not only come to old people, but they come to young people as well. I knew a young lady a few years ago. She was in her early 20s, and she would always complain about headaches and migraine headaches. And she never went to the doctor about it, but she just kept popping Advils and aspirins and Tylenols and Excedrin and anything else you could think of. And tragically, one morning, her mom went into her room and she was lying there dead, 21, 22 years old, simply because she ignored warning signs. Everybody say warning signs. David here in our text this morning, Psalms 139, 23 through 24, he said, "Search me, O God." He said, "Know my heart, try me, and know my thoughts." He said, "Please, God, see if there be any wicked thing inside of me, and lead me in the way everlasting." David, in no uncertain terms, was saying, "God, look inside of my spirit. Give me a sign to let me know if I'm still saved or am I backslid. Let me know if there are some things I need to change in my life. Are there some people in my life that I need to disconnect from? Are there some better decisions that I need to make?" And maybe there are individuals right now in this sanctuary, on the sound of my voice, that maybe God has been giving you some spiritual warning signs. Maybe some of you on the sound of my voice have began to touch, look, listen to, and even taste the unclean things of the world, but God loves us enough that he has given us another chance to get it right, because if we keep ignoring his warning signs, we will surely perish. I want to quickly give you six warning signs for your spiritual life. If you have something to write with, this would be a good time to write now. Six warning signs for your spiritual life. The first warning sign for your spiritual life is this right here. You are now entertained by things that once grieved you. Write that down. You are entertained by things that once grieved you. That is a warning sign for your spiritual life. You are now entertained by things that once grieved you. As I talked a little bit last night, in passing about my testimony, when God restored me, when he renewed me in 2004, I cleaned out my life. I went back in my car, matter of fact, that same night when I got up off of the floor from repenting and praying, I got in my car that very night and I threw away all of my worldly CDs. I was driving down the street and just threw them out the window, just threw all of my CDs, and that was back in 04, so of course, you know, iTunes and stuff really wasn't that popular, so we had CDs. I threw all my CDs out of the window. I had marijuana in my glove compartment. I threw it out of the window. And can y'all believe I even had gold teeth? I was gripped out. Can y'all believe that? Sometimes I look back and how foolish I was. You know, I had the grills and stuff. I had all the jewelry. I threw all that stuff out of the window. If that wasn't enough, I went down my cell phone. I don't think I was on Facebook. It might have been MySpace back then. Who's still on MySpace? Is MySpace still relevant? Is that? Oh, okay, nobody know. Okay. I went on my MySpace account and deleted all of my no good friends, and I went in my cell phone and deleted folks that meant me no good. Went to my computer, cleaned up some stuff. I stopped watching ungodly things. Nobody had to tell me to do this. I was breaking up with the devil, and I no longer had a need for any of these articles of worldly affection. However, any home that has been swept and cleaned will once again become dirty if it is not maintained. Luke chapter 11, verse 24 through 26, the Bible says, "When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, and finding none, he saith, I will return unto my house whence I came out. And when he cometh, he findeth it swept and garnished." Listen to verse 26. "Then goeth he and taketh to him seven other spirits more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first." If God ever forgives you, if you have a backslide and God brings you back, you and I, we do not have the luxury to go back out there again and test the world again, can you imagine? I know me. Now, I was messed up. I was tore up, y'all, from the floor up. I mean, I was just gone. But yet, I was fortunate and blessed enough to make it back to the house of God. I would be foolish to now leave the house of God and go back out there in the world again. The Bible says seven spirits worse than before. I barely made it back then. I can imagine being seven times worse than I was before. The Bible says that once the unclean spirit has left you, you have to make sure that you put something inside of your house. Because when the devil come knocking on your door again, peeking through the window, if he sees it clean and empty, then he knows that it's still vacant and he can come back inside. It's not enough just to throw everything away. You got to bring something in. You got to start praying. You got to start reading your word. You got to start worshiping. You got to bring something inside of your house. That's the very first warning sign, hyphen, that you are now turning, listen to me, on things. You're now watching stuff that at one time you said you would never watch. Warning sign. Warning sign. It's a warning sign if you can watch stuff full of nudity and not be convicted. Y'all quiet now. It's a warning sign if you can watch stuff full of cussing and homosexuality and adultery and fornication, and now, listen to me, be entertained rather than being grieved like you used to. Have you noticed that, and I know we're apostolic, I know we don't watch TV. Amen, amen. Have you noticed that the number one sitcoms that come out, they all are full of homosexuality? I don't care if it's Scandal. I don't care if it's Empire. I don't care what it is. It's all full of adultery, fornication. Don't get quiet on me now. It's all full of adultery, all kind of mess. And do you remember at one point you said, I would never be entertained by that. That stuff grieves me. But when you can find yourself eating popcorn and tweeting about it and enjoying it, and now it entertains you and not grieves you, that's a warning sign. That's a warning sign that you are heading the wrong direction. Here it is. Are you now listening to music that you once said, I would never listen to? Are you hanging around certain people who you vowed to stay away from? You see, you have to understand, young people, that it's not enough to get people out of your cell phone or even off your social media accounts. You got to get them out of your mind. You see, that's the problem. The devil understands you can delete their number all you want, delete them off Facebook, but all it takes for them just to send you another friend request again. And if they are still in your mind, the devil knows that he still has you, because the body will always follow the mind. You got to say, God, don't only take them out of my physical space, but get them out of my heart. They mean me no good. Get them out of my life. Are you going to places that you said you would never go back to? Are you dressing a certain way? We're going to have some personal inventory in this session today. Are you dressing a certain way now that at once time it used to grieve you when you saw other people dressing like that? That's the first warning sign that now you are being entertained by stuff that once grieved you. Let me hurry. The second warning sign for your spiritual life, the second warning sign for your spiritual life is that you are silent where you once spoke. You are silent where you once spoke. Write that down. Second warning sign. You are silent where you once spoke. It's a warning sign when a child of God does not open up their mouth and share the gospel with the world. Acts chapter 1 verse 8, the Bible says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be, not maybe or not might, you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and into the uttermost parts of the earth. Notice right here, the Bible says that after you receive the Holy Spirit, you may not necessarily become a preacher or a musician or a singer, but you will become a witness.
The truest evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is a tongue that has been set free and set on fire with the gospel. Do you remember when you were first saved, when you were on fire for God? You remember that you wanted to share the experience with your friends and your family. You had a fire burning inside of you. My question today is, do you still have that fire? Or now has your voice gone silent? Your silence may be the sign of a backslidden heart. Something is wrong, young people, when we can sit around and talk about everything else in the world for hours and get bored talking about Jesus for 5 or 10 minutes. Sit around and talk about who's better, LeBron or Kobe. Talk about the new shoes and talk about the latest fashion and talk about the newest movie that's on Netflix, right? Talk about all kind of carnal stuff. But when it's time to share Christ, I don't want to be too spirit. I don't want to be super holy and super deep. That's a warning sign. It's a warning sign when it's easy to talk about everything else except the things of God. The third warning sign for your spiritual life, the third warning sign for your spiritual life is that your prayer closet has cobwebs and your Bible is dusty. Third warning sign, your prayer closet has cobwebs and your Bible is dusty. Listen to me, young people. No man or woman is greater than their prayer life. You can dance and shout all you want, but when it's all said and done, you better make sure you have a prayer life. The believer that does not spend time on their face before the Lord and in His Word is quietly telling the Lord, I've got this on my own. Jesus said in Matthew 4:4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Listen to me, young people. Prayer is not an option. Prayer is a necessity. There is no way in the world you can live a victorious life without prayer. Much prayer, much power. Little prayer, little power. There are many situations that you may get by without prayer, but there will come a time in your life where only prayer is going to work. Many of you right now, you're at this hyphen, this 18 to 30 age. You are in college or getting ready to go to college and trying to figure out a career and thinking about who I'm going to marry. I'm looking at purchasing my first home, and you have a lot of major decisions in your life. You cannot make these decisions based upon what your peers are doing, based upon what your peers are saying, based upon what Google.com said. Y'all know how we are. We Google everything. Y'all not going to be honest with me? Am I the only one? We Google everything. If my stomach hurts, I'm Googling it. And now I'm scared thinking I got cancer or all kind of stuff. And it was nothing but heartburn and indigestion. Amen. Amen. You can't Google some things. Google is good and we use it, but you can't Google everything. There's some things you got to get on your face and you got to say, God, is she the right one? Is he the right one? Should I go to this school? I know this career will bring me a lot of money, but will I lose my soul in the process? You got to get on your face before God. There are some things that only prayer will work. You remember the story in the Gospels where Jesus told his disciples, they tried to cast out an evil spirit and they couldn't do it. Jesus looked at them and he said, this kind only comes out by prayer and fasting. There's some things you can't dance off. There's some things you can't run off. You can't shout off. You can't even scream off. There's some things that you're going to have to lock yourself away in a closet and you're going to have an old-fashioned press. There's some things you got to learn how to push the plate away, turn the computer off, turn your phone off, and fast from some things. Coupled with prayer. As a believer, you must also read the Word of God. Psalms chapter 119. Let me hurry. Psalms chapter 119, verse 11. The Bible says, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. If you are constantly sinning, that's a warning sign that you're probably not reading your word enough. The fourth warning sign for your spiritual life, the fourth warning sign for your spiritual life is that you are more likely to criticize the church service than to contemplate the message. Let me say that again. The fourth warning sign, make sure you're writing these down and go back and reflect on them in your private time. The fourth warning sign for your spiritual life is that you are more likely to criticize the church service than to contemplate the message. One more time. The fourth warning sign for your spiritual life is that you are more likely to criticize the church service than to contemplate the message. Philippians 4 and 8 says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, here it is, think on these things. Here's my question. When you leave a church service, are you thinking about what you agreed with and disagreed with in the service, or are you taking the service to heart? Criticism is a sure warning sign of somebody who is backslid. Criticizing another person, here it is, says more about you than it does the person you're criticizing. Write that down. Criticizing another person says more about you than it does the person you're criticizing. Folks trip me out sometime. I know it don't happen up here. It just happened back home in Atlanta. It trips me out sometime how folks, they sit in the crowd and they judge people, for how they sung or how they preached or how they played. But here's the problem. At least they're up here trying to be used by God. It's like folks who go to games and they sit there and they complain from the stands. I wish you would make that free throw. I wish that you would throw the ball further. I wish that you would score and do this or whatever. And we complain, but at least they're in the game. It's so easy sometimes to be critical from our seat. It is a very sure warning sign, listen to me, when you expend more energy criticizing the preaching, criticizing the singing. You have to get this early, young people. Listen to me. Criticizing the person that was on stage, because you will reap what you sow. Because one day the circle may change and God may move some things around and you may be up here one day and you're going to want people to pray for you and to support you and to celebrate with you. But if you sit there from your seat now and be critical, trust me, it will come back around to you. We cannot come to the house of God and sit here and be critical of every single thing that's going on. Sure, everything may not be perfect. Sure, everything may not be right every service. The preaching may be too long. The singing may be off key. The service may be boring. But instead of criticizing and critiquing it, you just yourself, you get into the presence of God all by yourself. And if you really get in his presence, listen to me, you will not have time to worry about anything else. Get your eyes off of people. Get your eyes off of man. And put your eyes on God. And I promise you, you will not have time to be critical. Once you enter into the Holy of Holies, you see, true worshipers, they don't need the beat of a drum. They don't need keyboards. They don't need a praise team. It don't matter who's preaching. It don't matter who's singing. If I enter into the Holy of Holies, I'm only entertaining one person. I can really care less who got the microphone. I really can care less if my neighbor's praising, my neighbor's worshiping. I have now entered into that secret place, and I don't have time to be critical. I really don't have time to be critical. The fifth warning sign, let me hurry. The fifth warning sign for your spiritual life, the fifth warning sign for your spiritual life is that you now excuse sin. Yeah, ain't nobody shouting, ain't nobody running with me today. Yeah, that's the fifth warning sign for your spiritual life is that now you excuse sin. 1 John chapter 1 verse 9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins. Notice the key word, confess. and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Whenever you excuse your sin instead of confessing your sin, that's a warning sign that you are drifting. You are backsliding. Here it is. It's not sin to you. You call it a mistake. You call it a blunder. You call it a defect. You call it a slip up. You call it being young and being free. You call it a generational curse. No matter what you name it, sin is still sin. Yeah, let me say that again. No matter what you call it, no matter what the White House calls it, sin is still sin. If it was sin yesterday, it's still sin. Y'all starting to scare me now. It's still sin today. If it was wrong yesterday for men to marry men and women to marry women, it's still wrong. I don't care what the president says. I don't care what the Presbyterian Church says. I really don't care what Beyonce and Lady Gaga says, or Sam Smith, or Macklemore. It's still sin. And that's a warning sign that you are backsliding when now you justify it. So what excuse do you keep using to justify your sin? People say, well, I was born like this. I don't have time to deal with that argument. Even if that's the case, we understand that we were all born into sin. That's fine. Okay. But that's why we have to be born again. You can't justify your sin. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All old things are passed away. You can't make any excuses for your sin. That's why David, ladies and gentlemen, is a man after God's own heart, because he never excused, he never extenuated his sin. But when Nathan the prophet confronted him and said, you are the man, you committed adultery against Bathsheba, you killed and murdered her husband in cold blood, David didn't look around and blame Bathsheba. He didn't say, man, that girl was naked, she was fine, she shouldn't have been bathing in front of me, it was her fault. He didn't blame Saul for always trying to kill. He didn't even blame his daddy Jesse, because his daddy rejected him and he had issues from childhood. He didn't blame nobody else. He simply said, I am the man. He turned away and said, God, please, I've sinned against you and you only. Please forgive me. That's when you know you're a man and woman after God's own heart, when you don't make excuses for your sin. You don't make excuses for your sin. That really was the major sin that really ostracized Adam and Eve in the garden. God said that if you eat of this tree, he said, you will surely die. We know that Adam and Eve, they took of the forbidden fruit and they didn't die. Yeah, they were still walking around in the garden, and Jesus still came looking for them. Here it is. He didn't first come and say, you've ate of the tree, now get out of my garden. He first asked them about their sin. He said, let's reason, let's talk about it. He says, what happened? The first thing Adam did was say, it's that woman you gave me. Eve said, I got to find somebody to blame myself. It's the serpent. He made me do it. And that's when God got fed up. That's when God said, get out of my garden. Get out of my presence. Now, I can't clarify this for say, but who knows if Adam and Eve would have just fell down and said, we're sorry, God. I can't blame it on him. I can't blame it on the devil. The devil didn't make me do it. My wife didn't make me do it. It was me. That maybe God would have gave them a second chance. Listen to me. Why try to cover up and hide and conceal your sin when God already knows it? The pastor may not know it. Your youth president may not know it. You may have done it in a dark room. You may have closed the door and locked the door and threw away the key. But guess what? God never sleeps. He never slumbers. He sees every single thing. So when he catches you red-handed, don't try to conceal it. Don't try to blame it on your past. Don't try to blame it on your mother, your father. Don't try to blame it on on the system. Just throw your hands up and say, you caught me, God. I messed up. I need you to touch me. There's no way I can keep hiding and justifying my sin. I need your mercy. I need your grace. But whenever you want to harbor your sin, whenever you want to try to hide your sin, that is a warning sign for your spirituality. The sad thing is that even in a crowd like this, and I'm reaching for somebody. I didn't come to play games with you this weekend. I'm reaching for somebody this weekend because there's somebody even right now that's saying, preacher, I hear you, but I'm not even convicted anymore. I like what I'm doing. Yeah, I'm enjoying my sin. You know what, preacher? I don't even pray for deliverance anymore. I'm not even tired of doing it. Let me enjoy my season. Well, you better be careful with that season. Because the Bible says that sin is pleasurable for a season. My question is, how long is a season? Your season may be 2 days. Your season may be 3 years, 20 years. We don't have the luxury to take that chance. Nobody really understands when God says your season is up. Once again, I was one of the fortunate ones that made it back to the house of God. I just lost my best friend. We had his funeral in December back home in my church. Church was packed out. My best friend growing up, his dad was a pastor as well, childhood friend. He was 29 years old and got murdered in the streets of Atlanta. He left a club one night and he was at a McDonald's. And there was some gang activity going on. He wasn't the gang, but the people that was in his car were gang related. And somebody came to the window, the drive-thru window at McDonald's, pulled the gun out and tried to shoot the other gang member in the driver in the passenger seat, missed him, and shot my best friend twice in the head. 29 years old, grew up in a pastor's home. Me and him, we were both backslid together. And when I came back home, he said, I ain't ready yet. It's not my time yet. And he lost his life out there in the world. Hear me, young people. If you are even contemplating, even thinking about leaving the house of God and going out there in the world, let me save you the trip. There's nothing out there but death, damnation, and destruction. You better hear me. How much time do I have left, Brother Titus? You better hear me. There's nothing out there. Listen, the devil will show you up front everything you want to see. You remember the story of Samson and Delilah. Delilah showed Samson everything he wanted to see. She knew that Samson had an appetite for women of the night. She showed him everything he wanted to see. But the Bible says that when the Philistines came into the room, the Bible says they came from an inner chamber. They came from another room. Listen to me. Delilah never showed Samson that inner chamber. She never showed him that other room. She only showed him her bedroom because she knew that's really what Samson was after. You better hear me, young people. The devil will show you the room that he knows the stuff that's in it that you really want. If you want fast money, if you want a lot of women, if you want the good life, and you want to be popular, and you want to be famous, if you want to go out there in the world and live that party scene, he will show you the gold, the glitter, and the fame, but he will not show you that once you get in that room, he'll call some other demons from another room, and they will hit you with all kind of spirits. They'll hit you with spirits of perversion, spirits of suicide, spirits of homosexuality, spirits of death. You better hear me. You better stay in the house of God. You better grab a hold to the altar, and you ought to say, I don't care how rough it gets. I don't care how boring it gets sometime. It's safer to stay in the house of God. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 in the world. There is no way in the world I am leaving the house of safety. I was one of the fortunate ones that made it out to tell the story, but my best friend lost his life in the streets of Atlanta. I talked about it last night, and now I got a 25-year-old sister who's musically talented, who was our choir director singing and playing, and now she's backslid, living that lifestyle, and I pray every day, please protect her, God. Please keep her. Don't let her die and go to hell being raised on apostolic pews. Do you understand the privilege and the honor that you have from being raised in the truth? There are people out there right now who wish they had an opportunity to come to a riot, to be in a district like this. But yet some of us, we are so spoiled. Some of us are so ungrateful. God has given us all of this, and yet we still want to turn around and say the world still looks good and the world still looks glamorous. You better get your eyes on Jesus and get your eyes off of Sodom and Gomorrah. There is nothing out there but death.
There's nothing out there but death. Be seated. I'm sorry, y'all. Be seated. Somebody needs to hear the warning sign. And before this session concludes, somebody needs to find an altar and confess your sins to God, lest you perish. The sixth and the final warning sign. The sixth and the final warning sign, hear me, for your spiritual life. The sixth and the final warning sign for your spiritual life is that you don't like what I'm preaching right now. Yeah, write that one down. I got some of you, huh? Yeah. The sixth and the final warning for your spiritual life, and I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, amen. I can tell by your face, is that you don't like what I'm preaching right now. Yeah, 2 Timothy 4 and 2 says, preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, here it is, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come where they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. If this kind of preaching offends you, that's a warning sign. You like stuff that tickle you, stuff that sounds good and feels good. Yeah, you like candy sermons and candy preachers. They shall turn away, verse 4, their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Preaching, ladies and gentlemen, is a double-edged sword. Preaching should not be one-sided, all about blessings, nor should it all be about damnation. There has to be a healthy balance, but a clear warning sign that you are backslid is that you don't like hearing preaching of correction anymore. You don't like hearing preaching of rebuke anymore. That's old school preaching, man. You know, I mean, that's 20th century preaching. We don't preach like that anymore. Have you noticed that the largest churches in our nation, Joel Osteen and T.D. Jakes and Andy Stanley, even back home in Atlanta, they don't preach correction. They don't preach rebuke, and people flock to those churches. Folks don't want to hear old school messages that corrects them, that reproves and rebukes them. That's when you know your spirit is heading for destruction. If I'm sick, I want to go to a doctor that's going to diagnose the true problem and tell me the truth and not skate around the issue and tell me how good I used to be or how good I am. If I'm unhealthy, I want a good friend that cares enough about me to confront me about my eating habits and don't keep tempting me with honey buns and powdered donuts. Come on now. If I'm swimming in a mountain of debt, I don't need a friend offering me another loan. I need a true friend to cut up all of my credit cards. If someone is always telling me how great I am, how blessed God wants me to be, but they never step on my toes, they never deal with the areas. No, nobody is perfect. They never deal with the areas in my life where I am falling short. Here's the stark reality. Do they really care about me? Sometimes, write this down, sometimes caring means confronting. Yeah, caring means confronting. Sometimes my flesh, even at home, my flesh does not like it when my father or my bishop
gets up, and you can tell it's going to be one of those services. I mean, they're in rare form. They're just popping everything. Sometimes our flesh don't like it, but we need it. The Bible says the Father chastens those that he loves. If this message in this session seems to be offensive to some of you, don't criticize the preacher. Cross-examine the hearer. Yeah, don't criticize the messenger. Cross-examine the hearer of the word. Stand. My time is almost up. Everybody stand with me all across this house. The Apostle Peter, as you're standing, the Apostle Peter, as anointed and as powerful as he was, even he went through a process of backsliding. When Jesus was at his lowest moment, Peter, he left him and he went back fishing. You know the story. He denied Jesus three times. He even got so agitated one time, y'all, that he said some four-letter words. He cussed. But the awesome thing about Peter is that while he was backsliding, listen to this, he realized it. He remembered the warning signs that God gave him. And he went out and repented. Matthew chapter 26, verse 75, last verse, and I'm finished. Matthew chapter 26, verse 75, the Bible says, and Peter remembered the word of Jesus. Listen to me. He remembered the warning signs, which said unto him, before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. Peter went out and wept bitterly. You see, that's the difference. Judas went out, hung himself, committed suicide. And the Bible says he made and found his own place. Peter realized he was backslid, realized the warning signs that I'm denying the man that I walked with. I'm even cussing folks out. How did I get here? Instead of going out committing suicide like his brother Judas did, his friend Judas did, he went and found a place of prayer. He repented and he wept bitterly. And the amazing thing about this is that God did not hold it over his head. He forgave him. When Jesus rose from the grave, he said, go tell my disciples and Peter. Peter was given the keys and he preached on the day of Pentecost, just like God forgave Peter and he used him mightily. He can do the same thing for you if you would admit to these warning signs. Some of you are struggling with one, two. If we be honest, there's maybe a demographic of people in here that's saying, preacher, I'm struggling with all six. I'm messed up right now. I know I'm here right, and I know I look like, you know, I always look, but I'm messed up, man. Let's just keep it real. I'm messed up. I'm drifting. I'm wandering. I'm backslid. I'm here just to be here. I'm talking to you today. If you can repent and get it right today, God can forgive you and restore you and bring you back to a place of repentance. Why don't we come around this altar for a few moments before we transition into our general session the next few moments? And as you come in your own way right now, I want you to lift your hands right now. I want you to search yourself. I'm not going to ask anybody to pray for somebody else. This is not a service where your neighbor go pray for your neighbor. And I know last night there was a lot of collective worship and a lot of collective praising, but this session, we're not doing it today. I don't want nobody laying hands on nobody. I'm not going to lay hands on nobody either. Today is personal inventory, personal inventory. All across this house, you can kneel down at this seat, you can kneel at this altar, you can stretch out and pray. But I need you to look inside of your heart the same way David did. David said, search me, God, search me, search me. Man, I can't fake it till I make it. Search me, God, search me, search me, search me. Search me and see if there be any wicked thing inside of me. Come on, that's it. Search, 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 search. Come on, young adults, come on, search. You ain't kids anymore. You're a young adult. Search. Nobody had to baby you. Nobody had to tell you what you're watching. Nobody had to tell you to clean up your Netflix account. Nobody's had to tell you to clean up your iTunes account. Come on, man up, woman up. Heed the warning signs. When you can laugh at dirty jokes. Years ago, it used to grieve you. It used to grieve you when you would see people backsliding and not coming to church. But now you yourself are in a backslidden state. What happened? What happened? What happened? Go back to the place where you failed. Go back. to the place where you left him. Go back today. Go back. Go back. Come on, that's it. Come on, that's it. Some of you used to wake up every morning before you went to school, before you went to work. You wouldn't leave the house without praying. Now, only time you pray is when you're in trouble. Only time you fast is when the church is fasting. Come on, go back to that place. Return to your first love. I'm heeding the warning signs. Just like Peter, I'm heeding the warning signs. I'm heeding the warning signs. I'm not going to ignore it. I'm not going to keep ignoring it. My spirit is not right. My heart is not right. My attitude is not right. And I can't fake it any longer. God, I'm filthy. I'm unclean, God. I'm dirty. And I need you to touch me. Come on, that's it for a few more moments. Come on. Somebody ought to be laying out before the Lord right now. Somebody ought to be repenting right now. Come on, God loves us enough that he didn't kill us. He loves us enough that he didn't cast us out of his presence. But he sent me all the way from the ATL to come and to help somebody understand that he's giving you another chance. He's warning you. He's warning you. Do not ignore the warning signs that you feel. Don't ignore them. Don't ignore them. Because you can ignore warning signs in your health and eventually it will kill you. It's the same way in the spirit. You keep ignoring spiritual warning signs. Eventually, your spirit man is going to die. Your flesh is getting stronger every day. And your spiritual man is dying. God, I got to have my heart right, God. God, you look beyond all this preaching that I do. You look beyond all this singing that we do. You look beyond all this dancing, all this shouting, God. All this public stuff that we do, God. You're looking at my private life today. You're looking at my life when I'm in my room by myself. When I'm in my car by myself. When nobody is around. That's what God is looking at today. Take a personal inventory, not of your public life, but of your private life. Come on, that's it. Come on. Many of us, we have this grand life on Facebook and Instagram. All of us do. We try to appear like we're perfect. But God said, forget all of that. Look inside of your private world. The world that nobody sees. The conversation that nobody hears. The thoughts that nobody knows about. I want to deal with those today. I'm heeding the warning signs. 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 Help us, God. Help us. Help us to search ourselves. Help us to search ourselves in the name of Jesus.